speak about her literary journey and also maybe read out from her works a bit. And after that, the floor is open for anybody who would like to ask her about any of her books or writings. Thank you.
Garage, a room above the parents' garage, and it's supposed to be very laudable. I had it very, very easy. I would love to be able to sit and be supported, and though it's personally tough, it's personally very difficult to get yourself out of the bed and to your desk and begin every day. But to my father had put down this condition that I want you to be independent in any which way. So I'm going to support you till so and so time, and then you're on your own. Which is not valid now. Now if I ask him for help, he would help me. But he just wanted to give me the reality push. So, I said, all right. And I knew it was now or never. So I took up a job at the Telegraph and to Calcutta. And I worked there for about a year. And who just managed to save about 35,000. With which I moved to another city, and I rented a room, I rented a computer, and the sari shop was already half written, and I finished writing it there in about 4 months. By a fluke, it got picked up by a good agent, and I suddenly I sent it out to some friends, and he sent me a mail saying he would like to represent me. I had no idea what agents were. I had no idea. I had no literary contacts, no background. I wasn't a doctorate. I absolutely had zero idea what this aspect of writing was about. However, I was fortunate that the sari shop did very well, and it was translated into several languages, won several awards. But a lot of hard work and pain went into that book. Pain as in actual physical pain, because I was too proud to go back to my parents' home till I had finished this. And so I had just a rented room, cold water in the winters, and hardly any furniture. But I was just like somebody possessed. So I know it sounds a little dramatic, but it's true. However, I think there's a flip side when a young writer, a writer with her first book, wins too many awards or accolades or praise, because then you become somebody else. It's like you see yourself from outside, and you feel, I'm still the same person who was struggling to put a story down on paper. And I am not this, like, you know the things newspapers call you, the literary find of the year, and I could not somehow relate to all of that. And so I retreated into a shell. And after that, I have a lot of unpublished work with me, actually. I wrote another manuscript, wasn't happy with it, some short stories. And then personal life took over, motherhood came in. I kept writing throughout, but there was nothing that I felt the urgency to publish. Then I started working on this novel called Tell Me a Story. And when I had finished it and I had sent it to my agent, who has also been senior editor of Picador, and I mean, he has a very good editorial sense that I trust, and he loved the novel. That is the point when I realized that in the current publishing scene, you know, we cannot really talk about writing in a meaningful way in a vacuum. In the current publishing scene, it exists in a certain way. That is when I realized that it sounds a little ugly, but you have to be somewhat of a networker in a good way or not. I'm not judging that. It comes naturally to some people, then, you know, but you're supposed to meet the right people, be seen at the right places in the right way. You're not supposed to offend certain people, which I do all the time. Though I have a very good opinion of myself, I think I'm very polite and very inoffensive, but I somehow do end up not massaging egos. So I realized that, you know, that was working against me, and my agent told me so, you know, as much in as many words, taking names, that, you know, this person is saying this and this person is saying this, and you refuse this invite and that invite, and by the way, that's not why I'm here. So I said, so be it, I'll go my way, and you have, if you wish to support me, it's all right. If you wish to terminate our contract, it's fine with me, but certain things I will not sell out on. And he said, I'm with you. You cannot keep a real rider down for long. So right now I have been working on a book set in Punjab, in rural Punjab, from where my father's village and that area, the Majha area. And it has been incredibly difficult to do because where people speak just Punjabi and they live in that world, to attempt a novel in English felt so fake sometimes. But I have just not read enough Punjabi, unfortunately, to feel comfortable enough to attempt a novel or anything in it beyond a conversation. I also wanted to experiment with the first person narrative, which I could not, because obviously somebody in a village, and these are people I can relate to, I know them very well. They are visitors at home. I go to these villages as a relative. So it just seemed incredibly weird to have one of them suddenly start saying I in Punjabi, and it's not been easy in English either. I'm at the editing stage of this novel. Hopefully it's going to release later this year. So these are the three pieces of work that I can talk about. Actually, I'm very bad at speaking beyond the point. Now, I do realize that both my novels are flawed in different ways. When I look back, actually, I can't bear to look back at them. They are flawed in different ways. But I feel that, you know, every new book, the process becomes even more and more difficult. And which is why when unpublished writers, younger writers come up to me and they say, do you have any writing tips or do you have any advice? I have absolutely nothing to say to them because I feel as clueless. And I just tell them that your only challenge eventually, you know, at the end of the day, with whatever responsibilities you have, with whatever your circumstances are, whatever your health conditions are, is to put yourself in front of a desk and pen and paper or computer or whatever and put those words down. And it's like anything else. It's like, you know, there is this romance around creativity, and you get especially by journalists, you get questions asked about inspiration, where do you get your ideas from, where are these characters real? You have none of these answers because sometimes you have to just, you know, rub Bolini on your shoulders and pack up your kid to school and sit down, and you just have to write. And then you have time later to think about, you know, what's the value of your words, what needs to be rewritten, what needs to be edited. It's like any other work. You have to work hard, you have to practice. that's it, I guess. I really have no idea how to go all artistic about it, or how to, that I don't have any mannerisms that is supposed to, an aura that is supposed to go with the writer, because I think it is so much. A friend of mine once said, just stay true to your original impulse. You know, whenever you falter, you write mails to your friend saying, agent saying this, editor saying this, I'm feeling this, I want to change this, will you read the third chapter again for me? And he said, just stay true to your original impulse to write. Another thing that I hope I'm not boring you or rattling on. Am I making sense? Not a lot of noise. Okay, plenty to let me go. Here I would like to say that at a certain level, and this is without any bitterness, please. It's without any nothing like that. But it's true. Indian writing in English has been appropriated largely by the metropolitan elite. Not just by the metropolitan elite, but sadly, socialites. I mean, it's been appropriated so completely that there are these circles. We all talk about these literary incestuous circles, but then we go and we become a part of them. We do not befriend one writer and then say, okay, we are friends, but here I step back. Because you have a certain sense of priorities. That does not happen. It's mind-boggling. But I think that and the way they look at small towns, leaves out so much. Let alone the urban poor and let alone the rural. I think Adiga had this thing in his novel, something patronizing, where nothing against these writers. I love Vikram Seth's poetry. I like Adiga as a writer, but you have to notice when you notice something, and you have to call a spade, which is why one gets into trouble, and which is why one is not in newspaper columns and in every interviewed by every newspaper or magazine. That's all right. He says, these towns you pass through, with half-baked, something like half-baked men and half-baked towns, and I was reading that and I found that just so, and it wasn't said with any irony, or there was no hidden context there. It was just out there. It was just ignorant and it was just silly. I'm terribly sorry, this is a speech, but it was. And then Naipaul has, he has numerous attitudes, and A House for Mr. Biswas is one of my all-time favorite novels. It's an excellent novel. So I am very clearly demarcating people's work from their sensibilities here. And he says things like, I don't read women writers. So many, I just don't read pompous idiot writers, It's like, you cannot say things like that and they get away with it, because the small town, people coming from either small towns, and by small towns, I don't just mean small towns, but from the marginal spaces, away from the elite, maybe even in a big city, or a nobody who has no contacts, who perhaps doesn't have the carriage or the language or the whatever it takes. This is also allowed to happen. I don't know why this is allowed to happen. I don't know why these people are not called out. Because I really do not mean to be personal. These are just a couple of examples. This is rampant. one award from abroad, any Western place, and you are supposed to be this big deal. And I'm just stating the obvious. I mean, obviously, I don't need to say all this, but I keep repeating this because somehow it's not getting through. It's not getting, and it will not get into the mainstream ever. I know that. However, I shall keep repeating it whenever I'm asked to speak. And there is this whole adoration, and there's this whole weirdness. I mean, it's just not about literature. Like, either stick to literature or stick to celebrity adoration, which is fine with me, you know. You can like Hrithik Roshan, and you can like Vikram Seth, and you can like, anybody. That's different. Literature is certainly different. I mean, there's so much translated work you read, which is much, much better than any Indian fiction. We all know that, you know. And I think I'm really on one of my rattles now, so I should stop here and perhaps change it to saner slang. But yes, it does. It doesn't bother me. It angers me that these metropolitan socialites are the decision makers. They decide what is to be published, they assign values to work. I get letters and emails from people, snail mail as well, from people who say in flawed English that when I read The Sari Shop and after this incident happened, it is fairly disturbing in some parts. I couldn't sleep after that, and I can make out that this person is not comfortable with the English language, he or she is making mistakes, but I can also feel the emotion in that and the effort that the person must have put it to read the book in such a sensitive manner. And that's all, I think, because by default now, whether one likes it or not, and English is criticized in certain circles. Why do you write in English? You ask that. Why don't you write in Punjabi or in Hindi? But by default, it is a language. Say, I have read Sentimental Education in Leonardo Bovary, and I've read Chekhov in. I love Chekhov, by the way. This is the language I have done most of my reading in, and it's very natural that I should be expressing myself in writing in this language. And what I'm trying to say here is, though it's a language of privilege, it can be brought down from the ivory towers a bit. It can be normalized a little. One can try to talk sense, and many writers do, especially lately. Of course, there is this whole people writing about mythology and romances and breakups, and one doesn't know what is what, and they're bestsellers. I hardly remember any royalties, but what I'm trying to say here is that just because you're writing in English does not mean you're writing from that space. You can be writing from a marginal space. I was talking to a lady who is very prominent in literary circles. Now, her I will not name. I know it will blow up in my face very badly. But I told her that I feel more comfortable with certain writers in English than with others. And she said a very strange thing. She said, she lives in Delhi. I think, yes, she lives in Delhi. She said, but you never come over. You never try to mix with us. After all, we welcomed Jeet and Rana. That is Jeet Thail and Rana Das Gupta. We welcomed them and made them one of us. I said, that is the... And she's supposed to be intelligent. She writes... Can I have some water? that, you know, we welcome Drana and Jeet, but you, why don't you come over and why don't you try to mix with us? And I said, both Drana and Jeet are from the metropolis. So that's the point I'm trying to make here. And I like both of them as writers. I don't know them personally. I have perhaps conversed with Jeet online a couple of times, and I don't know them, and I do like their work immensely, but I didn't know where this was coming from. Why do we have to mix with each other? The best of my writer friends are those completely not connected with each other. We are connected because of friendship, similar literary tastes, or, human reasons, normal human reasons. So this whole idea of that there's this bunch and we get together. And then when I was in Italy, a gentleman told me, this is what in their conversation, why don't you come to my place sometime? He's been born and brought up there. And he said, why don't you come to my place sometime? And I've got this cheese from here and this wine from there, and we could do a little tasting. And I told him, I'm a Punjabi, I cannot tell one wine from the other. We just measure how much we need to drink, you know. And nothing wrong with what he was saying, but this is just whole, like, unless either join us or I have actually been told that all your career is gone. And I said, writing was never a career, it's work to me. And then he followed it up with a gem. He said, okay, well, then would you, this was in Italy, so he said, would you like to just stroll along and maybe we could pick up some Swarovski crystals? And I told him, I can't afford that. They just do not understand that nothing wrong with buying crystals or having that cheese or this wine, but they do not even have the sensitivity to understand that everybody is not coming from the same place. I openly tell people, look, I cannot afford this, you know, what you're doing, so I cannot be part of this. And they are like, come on. Come with us to this retreat and this writer's hill this and this writer's that this, and writing is not about that, you know. I hope I am still making sense, am I? Anna? Okay, thank you. Okay, so I guess that was a lot of anger. Now, I'd like to switch to the writing process. This was needed though, because I think this needs to be said and repeated, whether anybody likes it or not. And I do it in speech and in print whenever I encounter anyone in this context. Now, when I was writing my third novel, I realized how hugely ignorant I was about writing, even after having published two books. I had to start from scratch. I had to make the maps in my head. I had to, there's this village that I know of. And I realized that the vocabulary does not exist for us to express that in our words. And then I had to get into those lives. And then I realized that I know about some lives, but not about all of them. Also, if perhaps some of you know that Punjab is like Majha, Malwa and Doaba. So you might know one region very well, but you might be ignorant about the things, about the speech and the customs and the certain things in the other two. And so then I zeroed in on to Majha. Then I visited several times. Stayed there for a month or so, and with my relatives, and it was awful. It was really awful because someone once told me, a friend in Bangalore told me, oh, your father has a village, how beautifully pastoral, how but once you go and live there, you realize there's no... you encounter everything, patriarchy, very much in your face. And the way of life is pretty tough for us, city dwellers. And you get up at the... which I was lucky, I'm an insomniac, because you get up at the crack of dawn. So I would like... I didn't even go to sleep, so it's okay. And you face so much, you know. And it made me realize that writing is constantly about expanding your vision. And it doesn't have to go like this. It can also just, you know, zero in on something. Like, to focus on something, you might just have to zero in on something that was previously familiar and see it with unfamiliar eyes again. And then without judging, go into the process of storytelling. I think all the three novels have been very humbling for me. The process has been very, very humbling for me in entirely different ways. That's all, I guess. I do have the copies with me, but I don't guess I should I read or... had bought over the course of the past 5 months had kept him very busy. One day after reading Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, in brackets, or a favorite reader, in radiant essays, he had realized that the complete letter writer and the radiant essays were getting a little stale and boring now. He made another foray to the second-hand bookstalls to see if he could buy something new. The first book he had spotted in one of the bookstalls seemed promising, and he almost bought it the same instant. It was called Improve Your English, written by Dr. Ajay Rai. On the jacket, there was a note about the book. Ramchand read it hopefully. It said, "The importance of English is well accepted, importance of good English only more so. Ability to use and know effective English is the correct prelude to your successful professional career, as well as a dominant, commanding place in society. Success in the use of computers is very closely connected to the success in the use of English, since almost 90% of all the information that is stored in a computer is in English." Ramchand stopped reading right there. For one, he found the language a little too elaborate. And also the sudden introduction of computers into his already complicated efforts to study a long term. When he leafed through the book, his suspicions were confirmed. The book was too difficult, at least at this stage. It had passages in it that one was supposed to read carefully and then answer the following and correct and punctuate the following. He turned his attention to other books. There was a faded book that he was sure he could get cheap, a book called Quotations for All Occasions. Ramchand had always thought that quotations were something to do with fixing the price of wholesale fabric, but the book jacket explained that quotations were things of wit and wisdom said by great people. So he buys this, and the quotations were classified in alphabetical order. There were quotations in the beginning of the book about ability, a few pages later, adversity. The book went on to report the ideas and opinions of great men on everything from flattery to literature to tact, ending with youth, yukon, and finally zeal. It will stop there. I'll skip the second one. because I think they're too long. Can we start with the question and answer session?
Hello. My question is, what inspired you? What motivated you to write your first novel, The Saree Shop, and why did you name it so?
Okay, that's in two parts. I think the first novel was a very strong response to... Can you hear me? Can you hear me now? Alright, sorry. So the first novel was, I think, I was very young and it was a very strong response to the society I grew up in. And I think at a very personal level, it was also an attempt to make some sense of the chaos I felt surrounded me. I could not make sense of the world without writing, and I still can't. The name, I'm very bad at titles and names, at headings. So I think I had suggested two or three names. I didn't have a strong opinion about it. And I think the editorial team had finally picked the Saree Shop. I think at one point I had planned to call it Ramchand, just that. But I was told that no, this won't work, or I'm not good at titles actually. So that's why it's just called the Saree Shop, because that is the meeting point of this person, the personal assistant, the assistant, and of all the other characters. You know, that's the one thing they have in common, that they all either come to that shop as very wealthy customers, or as workers, or as the Malik, or as something or the other. That's the confluence. So, just default.
Hi, Rupa.
Hi.
There's a lot of angst in you. I was just wondering, what would you be writing? Were you less angry?
Now, this is a question I'm often asked. There is actually no angst in me. I am a very calm person, an extremely calm person, and in real life I rarely lose my temper or raise my voice or have any aggressive behavior. I think there are certain things one should be angry about, and I think especially writers, it's okay, you know, to respond as honestly. If you see, you know, at any random day, you go out of your house and you will see 10 things you can get angry at. And there's certainly a lot of disparity in our society. There are things to be angry about. So why not? Why not express that? There's also a lot of love in my writing. But the thing is, because I'm not writing love stories or mushy or it's man-woman thing, so that the love gets swept under the carpet. But Ramchand, the protagonist, he has a lot of empathy, if you've read the novel. Have you? Well, then, you know, it's difficult for me to answer that, because in fact, both the protagonists in both the novels are people with a lot of empathy. And Ramchand feels a lot for a stranger, a woman he does not even know, you know, who has suffered violence. So that's there's a lot of love, there's humor, but it's all understated, you know. I don't know. I don't see myself as a person for love and story at all. And I don't want to write wishy-washy stuff either. I mean, I don't want to write feel-good books. And there are plenty of them out there.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
I want to know this handout which has been given to the audience narrates that you have an uncommon, rarer ability to look into the lives of ordinary people.
Okay.
Now, this quality, do you really have? Because this quality pertains to the intimation and interaction with the ground realities. Your career, in your career, what are the stages and how much interaction you have carried out with ordinary people? Or it's just a disillusion and your novels contain only imagination and the creativity. Thank you.
For one, those are not my words. I think somebody, they've been quoted from a review or some other place. I have not described myself as such ever. But yes, I think nobody in India of the middle classes, anybody say who's here in this room, has a functioning knowledge of English and of literature, can claim to really know everything about the lives of ordinary people. So, as far as my personal experiences go, there are a few which are private and which I would not like to talk about, which are things I do apart from, like, outside the writer's life, which I do, which time I spend as a person. But I cannot claim to know, and I don't think anybody of us can. Yes, sir?
Hello.
Rabindra, ma'am. Actually, being an author, how do you differentiate between this Indian, English in Indian language and the mainstream in English? How do you differentiate between these two different...
Could you repeat that? I didn't get it.
Actually, my question is that, what are the differentiation that you do find Indian English and the mainstream English?
I don't think there's any particular thing in the language. That, in fact, I write very sparingly. I write very short, basic sentences. I have a love for restraint in reading as well as in writing. So, I don't think I do anything differently, but I think my concerns are slightly different from, and I won't say that, there are plenty of other writers whom I relate to who are doing excellent work, and no, I'm not doing anything radically, drastically different. The whole rant against the metropolitan elite and yes, literary festivals and the whole commerce and the tamasha, is a separate thing, but my work is as good or as bad as any other writer's. I really believe that. And I'm just two novels old, three in my head, because I finished it, but it's not published yet. But that is not terribly experienced as a writer. I think if I write some 15 books plus, I might be able to say something else.
I have one comment and one question. The comment is, you have criticized what you call the metropolitan elites, very rightly. Most of them write in English. You are probably not part of that, although you write in English. And that brings me to my second question. Most of the great literature that's being written in India is not being written in English, most of it. And the translations are so bad that they're not readable. I tried my hand, my mother tongue is Odia, and I've tried to read some translations from Odia, and I just couldn't go through it. Are you ever going to translate, or are you going to be in your safe and comfortable space of writing in English?
Sir, I didn't get the last sentence. Which safe?
Are you going to remain in your comfortable space of writing in English so that you are accessible to an international audience? What about those great writers in our country who have no access internationally because the translations are awful? Are you ever going to translate, therefore, say from Punjabi or mother tongue?
I agree with you that the translations are terrible. I know that because I have read, because my mother is a great Punjabi reader, I have read a lot of good Punjabi novels as well as short stories. And yes, the translations are terrible, and yes, some of the work that is done in India and in other languages is brilliant. I agree with you there. At one point, I did say that I am not in a safe and comfortable zone in English. I did say that because my parents converse in Punjabi in home. I'm not from a background where English is spoken at home, or I didn't go to Oxford or Cambridge, or none of my relatives have been close to those places. And for me, it's just that all my reading was done in English by default, because I could not read Chekhov in Punjabi. He wrote in Russian. I cannot read Russian. He was translated into English. I read English. See? So my whole literary sensibilities got formed by the English language. So I'm not in fact, that's what I have been trying to say, and I'm glad you brought it up so that I can repeat it. It is not a safe and comfortable zone. In fact, one finds it more and more difficult to represent reality in a language in which the characters are obviously not speaking. I get your point there. And that's what I meant by that when I tried to write this, this third effort, Rural Punjab. It was even while writing it, I was so hesitant, which is why I don't I write in a very spare way, so that there is no baggage that I'm hanging on to the characters. I try to make the English take a back seat. And this is as honest as I can get. And bring the characters forward to such an extent that their lives, their conflicts, they shine through. And after I begin to write, there is also, I think with every writer it happens, there comes a point when the characters seem to take over. And then the process becomes easier. But it's just that your question is valid. There are no easy answers, and it is not a safe and comfortable space, and yet I have no other space. Because, to translate, you need to be equally, excuse me. As I was saying, it's not a safe and comfortable place, but I have no space to translate. You have to be equally good in two languages. Now, I love reading in Punjabi, and I love reading in English, but I am not able to, I'm just admitting it, I do not have the ability to translate, And also writing is a tiring job. You write a novel, and then either you're a writer, or like there are some good translators who do translation full time, and they put their all in it. So you can only give so much of yourself to your work. So I'm afraid I have no easy answers for you. Thank you for asking, though.
Rupa, how would you like to describe?
Sir, I can't hear you, sorry.
No, my question is this. How would you like to be described as a Punjabi writer writing in English or a writer in English who happens to be a Punjabi? Second question is that you have been translated in so many European and other languages. Have you seriously thought that your books should also be available more immediately to the people land in which you grew up, that is Punjabi translation?
I'm working on that. In fact, I did try to get the Sari Shop translated into Punjabi. I was not happy with the results, so I said no to the contract. And I would love for it to be translated. As for the earlier part of your question, I am not religious, let's leave that aside, but my cultural identity, yes, being a Punjabi, not just Punjabi, but being a Sikh is a part of that. For instance, I don't go to Gurdwara, so maybe I should not step into this, but the tradition of Langar is very, very important to me, and anywhere it is happening, I like to be part of it. So my parents are extremely, we have to, in my parents' house we have the Guru Granth Sahib at home, and that's all very personal, but yes, the Punjabi cultural identity is there. However, I left home when I was 18. I lived for long years in Calcutta, and the city was very kind to me. It was a cheap city to live in for someone who was sailing off to become a writer. It was safe for women. I've lived in Bangalore. I've lived in a village in Canada where I was helping out a friend about ordinary people. And so I guess it's a myth, which is why I say that a metropolitan is not necessarily cosmopolitan. So I usually am described as an Indian writing in English, and I think I'm comfortable with that. Does it answer your question, sir? Thank you.
Rupa, the way you got recognized with your first novel, can you share what were the special elements of your novel which you got recognized with?
The special?
Elements. What were these?
I have no idea, sir. I have absolutely no idea. Just happened. I don't know. I really don't know.
How did you get the idea of the woman in Sari Shop, the one who was victimized?
Susan. I think you're talking about Kamala, right? See, I think there was a lot of incident, there was a lot of repressed stuff there, a lot of things you read about and hear about, and you know that happened to people around you, but you are not able to do anything. And I think somewhere, as I said, that anger is necessary, you know. So she was very real to me. She wasn't inspired by any one real life woman, but she was inspired by several, it's a very common, very, very common thing that happens that she goes through, and it's just that. She was, the characters were born very organically, they were not thought out that this should represent this and this should, they were just there, they lived there.
I would like to thank you very much for your talk, which has been very interesting for me. And perhaps my question for my pre-speaker, you have suggested a sort of patriarchal discourses which you perhaps had to face both in your life and which you also thematize in your writings. So what about women in your life? I would like to ask if you also experienced a sort of solidarity among women, if there was a woman who was for you an inspirative example, either as a human or as a writer, who would be empowering for you and so on. Thank you very much.
I wish I could say yes, but it's both. It's, I have had the good fortune of having both good men and good women, actually in the form of my parents, because I have a sister, and I hope you get the context. In Punjab, being, and in other places in India, having to be two daughters is not supposed to be a very desirable thing, and my parents, who came from different villages, always found it extremely desirable, and they brought us up in a way that it's both of them. As I said, that my father had set a time limit for me that I needed to get independent. So it's, I think basically my parents, and also every, I mean, I'm, because I've never been to university and studied literature, because I have never had to write pieces or papers, I'm very personal about the writers I read. I have a portrait of Shekhar hanging in my childhood home, in my bedroom. And I think every writer who offered something as a teacher and inspired me, really, honestly. Yes, sir.
The central theme that you would have tried to convey in your flower, the central theme, as it is in every book, what they call in German, dies, are the spirit of the time in your novel, what you wanted to convey and you have conveyed. Number two, is it on the way to becoming India to the channel?
Do you
want
to be
India's bestseller?
Do I, sir? Do I sound like a bestseller to you? I will never be a best-selling novelist, and I'm very happy that way. I wasn't trying to convey any one single idea or illuminate any logo in the first novel. As I responded once before, it was my response to the world around me. It was an attempt to make sense of it. And I think as a writer, it's wiser to pose questions rather than attempt to answer them in my personal opinion, in a no-all manner, because I'm not there yet. I don't know anything. And I think if every writer admits his or her own ignorance to themselves before they sit down to write, we'd be better at our work. So I don't know, I really don't know. Perhaps the disparity, perhaps the walls that people build, people have built around themselves by the society. I don't know. There's so many moments in that which are all precious to me. In fact, the protagonists haunt me after the novel is over, and I have to tell them, go away, I'm done with you. These things don't leave you, They're a part of you. It's not just your brain, it's the whole of you responding.
I like your feeling towards the religious and legal setting and all. This I appreciate very much. Your reaction to metropolitan writing. I am also a writer in Marathi. When I, as you have already rightly said, in case chaos on fire. So situations come like that, and you even the language supports you. You have dialects, you have sociolects, all visual art, depth of view. So that depth of view counts very much when you are in chaos. Because I am a writer, I can go into the dialects, I can go into Gujarati, Kannada, or the tribals, English comes to you. When you play the cross, what you saw in English, you have to write in English. We have all these resources with you.
I do speak and understand both Hindi and Punjabi, and then little Bangla. And I do interact with everybody. And as I said, it's not just my personal telling, but it is a part of our history. In fact, I received the Sahitya Academy Award in English thing, you know, and I was rather surprised. I didn't know much about it then, saying that it is one of our languages. So I cannot either be apologetic about it, neither can I justify it. I get your point. It's a very valid point, especially maybe in poetry, and I do get it. But I think you also have to have your sensory antenna up. It's not just about the language. You can be writing in Punjabi and still be blind as a bat. You know, there are Punjabis, you go to Sector 8 in Chandigarh, and they are just playing ball on weekends and basically doing that whole Punjabi stuff. And then you go to Punjabi weddings, they are doing this Karan Johar weddings and blowing money and all that. So I don't see how they are more Punjabi in their sense, and they speak in Punjabi. They read Punjabi newspapers. I don't see how they would get someone like Ramchand more just because of the language, and I would get him less. Your point is very valid, but so is mine.
Rupa, I didn't want to ask, and yet I thought the last question. See, this resume talks, you are critical of many things, like somebody belongs to the club of metropolitan writers, somebody is a lead, social lead, somebody is writing on breakups, mythology. To which category of writers would you like yourself to be written? What is the class you are writing?
I think to an honest, unpretentious class who does not write himself.
Find your novel beautifully as confidence of ordinary people. This emphasis on the ordinary people, was it a reaction to the turmoil that had prevailed in Punjab, particularly in the countryside?
So actually, I was 6 or 7 when the Operation Blue Star happened, and I have memories of it, and of, you know, sleeping on the terrace because people were burning each other's houses down, and our parents being afraid and all that. But I don't. One incident did affect me very much. That there was a shoot at sight curfew announced one day, and my classmate's father did not know that. And he went out to see if he could buy a loaf of bread, and he was shot down. And I don't think I ever got over that, because I heard it at a very young age. But apart from that, I think it was influenced more. You know, if you live in Amritsar, it's a food heaven all one bookshop there, some bookseller's retreat or something, and there was just some commercial stuff, overpriced stuff there, and you had to go to the kabaddis, like Ramchandas. I did that actually. I used to cycle to the kabaddis and go through everything to see if I could get any books. And I think I was more affected by the whole claustrophobia. There was a lot of wealth. There's a textile industry in Amritsar. So there's a lot of wealth. I had classmates who were marrying rich men after class 10 or 12. And there are also weddings and lots of women, people talking all the time. I mean, it was a bit too much growing up. So I think that affected it more. And that sari shop's actually a real shop that I sometimes went to with older women. You know, because the bookstore would be on the way back. So it stayed in, I don't know, there's no logic to it. So I don't know why it stayed in my memory and why I used it. But no, not so much by the militancy and stuff, because I was too young then.
Can you say something about this very controversial write-up in this newspaper? Dark things do happen in Gurudwara sometimes. Can you say something about this controversial write-up?
Wait, about something about what? In what sense?
Yeah.
See, there was a play that had come out. There was a play, now it's more than a decade back since this happened, so I don't remember the details. A play had come out talking about the molestation of women by the clergy in a Gurdwara, and it was based on a true incident. And it happens with all clergy. I mean, no offense meant, but I don't have much faith in clergy anyway. They're too smug and to be real, you know. So, not all of them, but generally. And so I just, in London or somewhere the play was being staged, and that place was vandalized by Sikh fundamentalists. And I just wrote a piece defending the playwright, who was a woman. I don't remember her name now. And saying that it does happen and it can happen. You know, how can you vandalize a place which is staging a play? And the news had come in newspapers already. So, unless you criticize it, you know, that doesn't mean you are anti-Gurdwaras, but unless you criticize it and you point it out, you are not going to get to the rod. But a lot of people started calling up my parents, and I got a lot of hate mail and threats. And my father said, can you please go away from Amritsar for some time, because we are afraid for you. And so I did that. I was always doing that anyway. But then it all died down and everything does. I stood by it though, I did not retract it.
Thank you, Rupa. It's been a wonderful afternoon.
Thank you all for having the patience to listen to me and for giving me your valuable time. I'm really honored. And here's something I didn't say when I received the Sahitya Academy Award, but I would like to say it now, because I really dislike saying even semi-sentimental stuff, especially in public. When I won the Sahitya Academy Award, it meant a little more to me than the ones I got for the Italian translation and the Commonwealth Award and stuff, because I felt that this is what we need. We need to be recognized by our own people. If our own people exist, because one never knows.
Thank you, Rupa. It's been a really, really interesting afternoon, and post-lunch it is a very rare thing to happen that people have been listening and asking questions and trying just few must be to only two.
So I thank the audience for joining the program and being here, and that's all. And I think you can join us for tea, and later in the evening the future prize giving ceremony, the Science Academy Awards at the Kamani Auditorium. Thank you.